I pray for each and every person lost out in the world, Lord. I pray that you give us the wisdom, the guidance to reach someone today, Lord. Thank you for all you do. We love you. We need you. One love. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you.
Girl.
I wasn't created to live anymore. I hear your invitation to let it all go. Yeah, I see it now, I'm laying it down, but I know that. Just as I am. your sight on before my first breath. Running into your arms is running to life from death. Oh, I feel this rush deep in my chest. Your mercy is
song is one this morning. I listened to it, but on the way here, I was just thinking about what I was going to talk about. And, you know how we are; we try to figure it out. And, but I spent most of my life. The reason I went into my addiction is I spent most of my life seeking a father that I didn't know I had. My father was in prison my whole life, so I seek affirmation and I seek acceptance in all the wrong places. So I came. Started smoking weed and drinking, partying, so I had felt that acceptance. Then I started hanging out with guys that were a little bit older than me that were cooking meth and doing heroin and all that good stuff. And I went full-fledged ahead in it, because I thought that's how you were supposed to be a man. I thought they were supposed to sling dope, smoke dope, do dope, whatever. And I thought that's what you were called to be a man for. About 10 years ago, I was 22, 23, 2014. I've done the math like five times, but I forget every time. So about 22, 23, and I had done burnt every bridge there ever was. Mama wouldn't let me in the house. Sister wouldn't let me in the house. I didn't have really nowhere to go. Basically homeless. I got tired. Because, it got to the point to where every month I go to jail, and every 2 months I get out, and I turn right back around and do the same thing. And I didn't want that lifestyle anymore. I grew up in church, so I already knew who Jesus was, and I knew who the Father was, or I thought I knew who the Father was. See, I looked at the Father as a judgmental prick. That's how I looked at him as. Because that's all I know of him. That you do this, you're going to hell. You do this, you're going to hell. If you do this, I'm going to judge you for it. So I didn't really care for him. So a depression spirit got attached to me, and a suicide spirit got attached to me. And I ended up under a bridge in Coweta County, and I had a bunch of pills, sleeping pills, that I had stole from my older brother that I Googled that said it doesn't get you high, but if you take too many of them, you'll die. So because I had that suicide spirit attached to me, and in my thought process, I just stuck them in my backpack for backup plan, Well, I was under the bridge, and I'd been there for about 4 days. I ran out of money. I couldn't get no more beer, no more weed to go to sleep. And then the depression spirit really got a hold of me. And so I decided that I was done. I decided that this was it. I don't want to do this anymore. So here we go. But before I did that, I grew up in church. My granddaddy was a minister. My uncle was a minister. My mom dragged me to church all the way up until I was about 17 years old. So I had 24 pills in this bottle. I only took 23. And I believe that I only took 23 because I believe that the Holy Spirit flicked one of them out of my hand. I prayed to God, though, first. Let me get back here. I told the Father, I said, Lord, I said, I know you're real. I believed in you. I accepted you when I was little. I said, but I don't feel love right now. I don't feel like anybody cares. I said, but Lord, I said, so I don't want to be here anymore. I said, but if you have something you want me to do, wake me up. So I poured these pills in my hand, and one of them fell out. And I believe to this day that the Holy Spirit flicked one of those out of my hand. And so I took 23 pills. I woke up 4 days later. I done rolled around in some mess. I don't even know what I done rolled around in. So I go to wash my face up at the Pizza Hut, and this guy that is actually, it's really crazy, is he's actually a pastor now in the town that all of this started. And I was his first one that he brought out of darkness, or helped to lead out of darkness. So he stopped me on my way back to the bridge, and he asked me what I was doing and where I was going and this, that, and the other. And I came to the Valley Rescue Mission. He brought me to the Valley Rescue Mission. And that's where I really learned who the Father was. The reason I'm saying this is to see, Bobby, y'all all know Bobby. I call and talk to Bobby. Bobby's my buddy, man. I talk to him all the time. When I got something going on, I talk to him. When I get frustrated, I talk to him. That's just who he is for me. He's the guy that I call when I need somebody to tell me to shut up and listen to what God's saying. He told me a couple months ago, probably about 6 months ago, because I was struggling and dealing with stress and anxiety and all that good stuff. And he said something that really sat with me. He said, don't you think that God probably already gave you the characteristic that you needed to overcome this? And that really got me wondering, because I'm real big on identity. Really big on identity, because identity is the only reason I'm still sober today. Anyways, he said that, so I started looking back into my life and looking back and seeing what characteristics he's actually already taught me. And in this character, in this moment, in this situation, the characteristic that God was showing me and teaching me was that I had a father that I could run to. And I didn't even know I had a father I could run to. I didn't know that the God of the universe really cared about me, that he really knew me, I didn't really know him. You see, the first time I went to the Valley Rescue Mission, I learned all about who Jesus was. I knew who he was. I learned finally that he didn't judge me for my wrongs. I learned that my faith and my relationship with him wasn't based off of what I can do or what I did. But in that moment, I learned. Now, I didn't know that at the moment. This is 10 years later that I learned this in this moment. That in this moment, he was showing me that he loves me. He was showing me that I'm your father. You don't need other men to show you that you're to accept you for you to feel good. I already accept you. I'm already your father. I already have you. But at the same time, through that time when I was at the Valley, I didn't learn who I was. I didn't know who I was. But see, I'm also very hard-headed. My wife will tell you the same thing. Josh will tell you the same thing. God, if you talk to God about me, he'll probably tell you the same thing too. So I learned who he was, but I didn't know who I was. So I got out, and of course, you know, it's just like anything. I mean, you can, I don't really know how y'all's program works or how this works or whatnot, but you can go through the program, you can get to know Jesus, and you can trust on him and fully rely on him for a season. See, what happened with me was is he heard everything I asked for, and he gave it to me like this. But because I'm a man and I'm fleshly, I stopped saying, God gave me this, because he gave me a job as soon as I walked out of the door. Within 2 or 3 months, I bought my first car, and I said, shoot, see, I did it now. I bought my first car. I didn't buy nothing. God gave me a job to provide for it, and God gave me a car. So I took for granted that, so then that pride that the devil has is the same thing that we have. A lot of times, I did this, I did that, and I did that, so I forgot who gave me everything that I had. And part of that is I know that I've been called to do something for the ministry and for his kingdom. But see, because I didn't know who I was, I didn't feel like I was worthy enough to do it. I didn't feel like, okay, well I'm just a done it wrong, I've done this, done that, blah, blah, blah. See, that's where the enemy wants to attack us, is in our brain and tell us to bring back our past. And that's part of why it's really important and why Paul tells us in Philippians to forget the things that are behind us and reach towards the goal for the prize of the upward calling of Christ Jesus. He tells us that because if we continuously remember our past, and I tell you in my life, it's true. Because if I continue to remember my past, that past creeps back up in there, and then I don't do what I'm supposed to do because my mind is at war with feeling like I should have these things. So I went on a run, and I got to chasing after old tail, just like we all think that we should do. And I got hooked up with the wrong woman. She seemed good and nice on the outside. She went to church. She was working out of ministry. Good. Great. But didn't know what she did behind closed doors, you know. Found out, she was drinking, so then I made a compromise. Compromise my sobriety. I'm not a big drinker. I don't drink very often. I wasn't ever drunk anyway. I hated alcohol, so I'd drink some Fireball with her. That turned into finding out that she smoked that synthetic reefer that they used to sell.
Spice.
Yeah, Spice. Not the new stuff they got now, but Spice. Oh, that's okay. Whatever. So I still compromise because it's a woman, and you know, she's taking care of my manly needs, is what I thought. So I was at her house by myself. She was at work, and I was at the house by myself, so I started cleaning up. I found a roach, and the enemy, as soon as I saw that roach, he just attacked me. Oh, ain't nobody gonna know nothing. Ain't nobody even here. Ain't nobody gonna see. God does. So this is what's really cool, man, really crazy. So, heck, I skipped the part. No, I didn't. I ain't did it yet. Anyways, so I hit this synthetic now. Y'all can call me crazy or not, but God is legit and God is real, and he will try to stop you. He will. Because he doesn't want you to go down that path. Because like I said, he's your father. Any of y'all got kids?
Yeah.
If your son's about to jump off something that you know that ain't going to turn out pretty good, you're going to try to stop him, correct? Alright, so anyways, I hit this roach. About half one. I probably smoked it all the way down to where about nothing. And I'm sitting there and I'm looking at the TV, and you can say, people say, probably say it's the drugs, but I highly doubt it was the drugs. I ain't never seen this commercial in my life. But it was like one of them Nike commercials. And it was a guy running down the street, and there's stop signs just kept coming up there. Stop. Run. Turn around. Don't go. Stop. Turn around. Don't go. I didn't listen for nothing. I just kept on going full speed ahead. Eventually, the real characteristic of this woman really came out, and I had done squandered everything that God had given me, everything except for the vehicle that I had. And I stopped looking to the Father. I stopped running to the Father. I started trying to do everything on my own strength again. Well, of course, like any other man, I just continued seeking after another old tail, chasing after a woman. Who's anybody from here? I ended up at the Bamboo Motel, and I'm not from here. I'll just say this. I ended up at the Bamboo Motel. Bamboo Motel, fresh out of recovery, been in out of recovery probably 6 months. And the cockroaches come out at night, you know what I mean, at the Bamboo Hotel. I'm still working a full-time job. I'm still doing everything I thought I was supposed to be doing. Well, I brought a buddy of mine with me, and of course, he found it. I knew where it was at. I knew it was down there. So I relapsed on methamphetamines. This was the last. This was 10 years ago. This is give or take 10, 9, something like that. I relapsed and I went on a binge for about a week. After this, on the seventh day, I'm sitting here and I'm twirling my bowl, getting high. And I heard Galatians. I think it's Galatians 5, 6. I'm not 100% on it. But it comes out of the scripture. But I heard the voice of the Lord come into that hotel at the Bamboo Motel. I heard it plain as day. He said, "Why do you turn back to these pestilent ways? Do you not know that I already delivered you from this?" Man, I'm going to tell you something. When I heard that, that blew my mind, and I throw that pipe up against the wall, and I ain't touched methamphetamine since. I didn't stop smoking weed or drinking, but I stopped methamphetamine. But I still didn't listen to his voice 100%. I still wasn't all the way in. I still wasn't running to the Father. I was still trying to do it on my own strength. Heck, I hadn't stopped trying to do it on my own strength until here recently. But anyways, so I stayed in the Bamboo Hotel probably, I don't know, a couple months. Then I got hooked up with a girl, broke up with her, then I met some girl on the internet, and I ended up in Gainesville, Georgia, all the way up towards Lake Lanier in Hall County. I got up there. I had a really good job doing construction, remodeling AT&T buildings and stuff like that. It was New Year's 2016. She invited me to a party at her mama's house. So I blew my car up now, by the way. I don't have a car now. I have a Grand Marquis, but I don't have a license, and so therefore I don't have any insurance on it. So my brother brought me up there and dropped me off. And she told me I had a ride. I'll get you back down there before you got to go to work, because I was about to go out of town for a couple weeks to go to Tennessee to do one. I'll get you out of town, da-da-da-da-da-da. Didn't ever happen. I ended up shacking up with her for a couple months. Then I called her, come home from work. I started working at a warehouse, and I come home from work, and she was cheating on me with a neighbor. You know, I get pissed off, and police get called, and I get put in jail. But in reality, what it was is when I went to, everybody know Jensen Franklin?
Yeah.
So I was going to his church. We were still going to church. We were playing Mary. We were playing going to church. Let's go to church. Let's be a couple. Let's do this. Let's do that. And I heard Jensen Franklin, the Father speak through Jensen Franklin, telling me to stop what I was doing, that I needed to leave, that I needed to run, that I needed to come up here, and I needed to be in the ministry. You need to sit down, you need to stop, you need to fully surrender, you need to come to a discipleship program or whatever, and you need to get close to the Father. I heard it. I ain't listen at all. So anyways, because I kept running, I'm real big on running through the stop signs. full-fledged ahead. I'm real quick to run. I'm not going to wrestle God, but I'll run from him. Anyways, so I ended up going to jail for aggravated assault. Now, it wasn't just a regular old aggravated assault. It was she tried to say that I tried to rape her. So it was aggravated assault with attempted rape. And I didn't even know that when I got booked. I sat there for 4 months and didn't even know that. I thought I was just sitting there on aggravated assault. When the old public defender came, I said, I'll just plead out guilty to it. He said, I don't think you want to plead out guilty to it. I said, why? He said, because it's got a sex charge on the other. And I said, the heck it don't. I ain't doing all that. So I ran to the father in that situation. He finally got my attention. And I ran to the father. You know how it is in jail. You're going to run to the father either way. At one point in time, at Christ, you're going to run to him. It doesn't. It's what we do. It's what a lot of people do that like to play with God and ride the fence. When we get in trouble, we run straight to him. So I ran to him. Man, I was in max security, man. I'm this big. Max security in Hall County, in a town I don't even know. I'm in there with the folks that are looking at life in prison that done killed somebody, done beat the daylights out of somebody. That I'm watching people get their death. I mean, I watched a dude get his face cut with a razor blade 12 times, and they had to take him to the hospital and get 50 to 100 stitches in his face over a daggum suit. Me, little old me, in there with a bunch of bears. But the father was with me. They called me preach because I sat in there for a year. All I did was sit there and read my Bible. I sought his kingdom and his righteousness, and all the things were added to me. Yes, I was in jail, but everything I was taken care of. I had an aggravated assault. Everybody kept telling me, oh, they're not going to let you go to work release. They're not going to let you go to work release. They're not going to let you go to work release. They let me go to work release. It didn't last long because, again, I'm hard-headed and whereas in max I couldn't do nothing but read. In work release, I could go out and work and come back and smoke cigarettes that I wasn't supposed to have in there, whatever. Got caught with cigarettes, they sent me right back up. Wasn't even down there. Didn't even get to go out. The whole reason they sent me to work release is because that's so I could bond out. Uh-huh. But see, God didn't want me to bond out. God said I wasn't done. So I went back to max and sat there for another 3 months. Anyways, they finally, I told my lawyer he'd come up there and it was finally time for me to go to court. The lawyer said they're offering 10 years to the door. They're not changing their mind. I said, well, this is what you're going to do. He said, I told him, I said, I already got an acceptance letter into the Valley Rescue Commission. The whole time I've been there, I heard Valley, go to the Valley, go back to the Valley. And I was hearing go back to the Valley before I even got arrested. Go back to the Valley Rescue Commission, go back to the Valley Rescue Commission. So I knew that the Father was going to do it. I believed that with my faith that if I give it to him, he's going to take care of it. If I'm going to give him this burden, he's going to take care of it. He takes care of all your needs. If he takes care of the birds, he takes care of me. If he takes care of if he clothes the grass and the flowers, he's going to take care of me. So I had really strong faith in knowing that he was with me and that he was going to take care of it. I told the lawyer, I said, listen, I got an acceptance letter to the Valley Rescue Commission. I said, this is what you're going to offer him. You're going to offer him an 8 due 2. I said, I want the rape part dropped, and it's just going to be aggravated assault, and I'll plead out guilty, but you're going to send me to the Valley Rescue Commission. You're going to give me credit for time served, and you can bar me from this county. You can add whatever else you want to add on there. I don't care, but I'm going home, and I'm going to the Valley. They're not going to do that. They're not going to do that. Well, on my way there, to the courthouse, you know, we all ride in a van in the shackles. Before they let us out, I prayed. We all, a bunch of grown old burly men holding hands, prayed to Jesus to take and do what he does. Everybody that was in that van with me went home that day. Everybody. Because the Lord was with us at that very moment. The Lord is always with us. That's really good is I looked at the morning devotion. It's Isaiah 41, and it says, for I am the Lord your God, who takes hold of your right hand and says to you, do not fear, I will help you. Even when I was not being faithful, he was faithful. He still had my hand, and he was still taking care of me. The same way he's holding on to y'all's hand, and he's taking care of y'all. And he will always do that. Like I said, even when I was not faithful, he was still holding my hand. He was still going before me. Yeah, I still got tripped up over stuff because I wasn't paying attention to him. Because I guarantee you, he was telling me, don't go mess with that girl. Don't be chasing that girl. Don't be doing this. You don't need to go that direction. But because I wasn't paying attention to him. See, we get so, I get so overwhelmed, and I get to where I want to try to do it myself, but I don't pay attention to him telling me that's a trap. This is a trap. Go this way, and then go this way. Go up here, take a right, take a left, take a right, take a left. Instead, I'll take a left, then a right. And so I hit the traps because we don't look at him. We keep our eye. If I would have kept my eyes on him when I first met him, I would have been all right. I would have been good and dandy. Anyways, when I was in the courtroom, the girl was there. Her son was there. She even got up and testified and said that I was a horrible person, that I done traumatized her kid. The kid was already traumatized before I got there. But she was saying all kinds of horrible things about me, man. It was bad. It was bad. Then it was my lawyer's turn. And he told the judge, the DA and everything, what I was offering, what I would accept. The judge said, well, this is the toughest judge supposedly in this county. So I don't know. It used to be the governor's son. Governor Deal or whatever his name is. I don't know. But anyways, he was supposed to be really hard. He looked at me and he said, man, I have no idea why I am doing this. He said, this woman is here and she's telling me how much of a horrible person, how abusive you were, and how this, that, and the other. He said, but you offering and you expect me to accept the terms of this. He said, well, I don't understand why I'm going to do it, but I'm going to do it. He said, I'm going to get sent to rehab. I'm going to let you go home today and turn yourself in rehab. He said, and you're barred from this county. You can't come up here. You can't do this. You can't do that. If you, in the moment that you mess up, I'm going to revoke every last part of it. All right, that's what happened. Come down to the Valley Rescue Mission, where I met Josh and his little crazy self, sleeping back there, throw a book at you. Anyways, so I found out who I was this time around. I learned that it's not just Jesus who I need to know who he is. I need to know who I am. I need to know that therefore, there's no condemnation for anyone that is Christ. Therefore, anyone that is in Christ is a new creation. The old things have passed away. I needed to know that I am righteous in Christ based by faith, not by works. I needed to know that regardless if I read my Bible today, that just because I didn't read it today doesn't mean that I'm not any less of a believer than I was yesterday when I read it. I needed to know that just because I fall short doesn't mean he leaves me or forsakes me. I didn't know these things until now. And you see, when I really understood who I was, that is how I've been able to overcome my addictions. It ain't pretty, man. It is not pretty. This has not been an easy road, especially in the last year. Because he's still sanctifying me. It's a process. It doesn't happen overnight. Just getting sober is just part of it. Like, just in the last year, with being married, because I got married, I got out of this time, and I mean, he gave me everything I prayed for once again. I got married within 6 months, I got 5 kids, he's given me a nice truck, nicer truck than I've ever had. I bought my first house, all this stuff in the last 4 years. I mean, and it just all falls into place. I mean, didn't even really have to fight for it. It just all fell into place. The house, this is how I know the house is from God. The house was foreclosed on, right? So the bank owned it. I had a FHA loan. FHA loan won't let you buy a foreclosed house. I told my realtor, I said, this is the house we want. Oh, it's a foreclosed, they're not going to let you. I said, I don't care, get it. Do it. And guess what? I got a foreclosed house that I wanted. Well, my wife wanted. I wanted it too, but she wanted it more. But you know how that goes. But the Lord made a way for it. And we weren't supposed to get that house. Not only that, because see, we ended up, so we didn't even have to pay for the house when we first moved in. I didn't have to pay a dollar. I paid $170, but then they wrote me a check back. On a foreclosed house, you have to pay a down payment, and you have to pay the closing costs. all of it. Dadgum bank said, okay, we'll pay for the closing costs, we'll pay for this, and we'll pay for that, and you don't have to worry about it. We'll just escrow it in. Paid $170, and it was for a signing bonus, like signing fees. Then they turned around and sent back not only $170, but $220. I got a check in the mail, like, what is this? Okay, thank you. I'll take it. So everything that I have, I mean, and the same thing with the truck. It just fell into place. I didn't have to put nothing down. I mean, my credit shot, or was shot. I mean, it's shot now again because of credit cards, because I'm crap with money. But anyways, I didn't even have the good credit, but they still gave me the truck without anything down, nothing, not even a dollar. Got the truck. And guess what? Now I needed the truck. Because, see, like I said, in the last year, he's been working on me hard, man. There has been so much stuff in my marriage and stuff in my life, and I didn't even realize that I was still dealing with this stuff. I told all these things that the Lord showed me. He told me the other, not too long ago. He said, you're not trusting me. He said, you're not even trusting your wife. You're not trusting me. You still put guards up. He said, you can say all day long that you trust him, but I know your heart. I know that you really don't. Because, see, in my past, I've been cheated on. I've been done wrong. Everybody that I've ever loved has always done me wrong. So, therefore, in return, it's hard for me to accept Christ's unconditional love. It's hard for me to really fully give it to him. And this is when I met Chris. About a month and a half, maybe. He came to my church, and I was struggling and wrestling. I heard about 3 weeks before he came, I heard the Lord say, I want you to step out on faith and start a ministry in the company. I said, all right, God, cool, I'll do that. Yeah, let me put my fillers out. Let me go put some posts and see if I can get some jobs. 2 weeks, I didn't get a big gone hit. I didn't even get a message. Usually, I get at least a message. I didn't get nothing. Not a darn one. Then Chris comes to church, and in worship, I don't know what it is about that little church, but I hear the Lord more than I hear anywhere else. I hear more than I do in my own personal time. I hear him in that church. I heard the Lord say, quit. He said, quit your job. I said, what? I said, God, I said, you gave me this job. I said, you moved me up. I mean, I started 4 years ago, and I didn't know a darn thing about concrete. I couldn't even read a dadgum measuring tape. Barely. I could tell you where the inch was. I didn't know about 3/4, 1/8, all that nonsense. I said, Lord, you put me here. You moved me up so fast in this company to where within 6 months I was leaving the crew. Within a year, I was supervising a multi-million dollar job, making $18 an hour. And then within the last 4 years, I was making, if you break it down in time and hour, I was driving a company truck I was making $1,000 a week, so I was like $25 an hour for 40 hours a week, which I was working 70. You know how it works on salary. And not to mention, I just left and was out of town for a week because my wife's grandmother passed away. So I didn't even have a check coming. That month, that Sunday, I was like, okay, God, he said, quit. He said, I said, quit what? Your job. I said, okay, I'll do it. I'll do it Friday. I put my 2 weeks notice in and I'll do it Friday. No, now. I'm still fussing and fighting with him. Okay, God, I just put this in. No, now. Well, what about this? What about that? What about my bills? He said, don't worry about it. I got you. Trust me. Trust me. I go to counseling, Donna up there at my church, and it's for inner healing, and she told me about it, and I was talking to her about it. She says that God is trying to put me into a place to trust. I'm in a season of learning to trust him. Not only trust my wife, not only trust my kids and my family and all that, but also trust him. Because I love Jesus. I have faith that he'll provide because he hasn't let me down yet. But it's that little bit that he wants me to trust him just enough to just survive. But he wants me to fully trust him, fully rely on him. And that's what I've had to do in the last month and a half. Because I quit. My wife pushed me off the edge, but I quit. If it wasn't for my wife, I'd probably still sit there. I should probably still be working where I work, and I wouldn't be here giving y'all my testimony. She pushed me, and I took my truck and dropped it off. And as soon as I dropped, I mean, this is just crazy. When he says he'll give you a peace that surpasses all understanding and all, I mean, it's real. I was quitting my job. I was taking a truck back to Nostalgia, Alabama to my boss man's house. About to not have any check coming in Friday. My mortgage is due, my truck payment's due, my car payment's due. Everything that's big and the main ones are due, like within the next week. 1 week I didn't have no jobs, but I bid. I put a post on Facebook. Like I said before now, I put a post on Facebook and I didn't get nothing. I didn't even get a hit. I put a post on here. I was working from about 7, 8 o'clock all the way to 6 o'clock at night, going to people's houses, putting in bids. I only landed one, but that one's all I needed. And through this time, I mean, I've landed more now, but that was just enough to provide for my bills. Same thing happened the week before. I haven't made a profit enough to where I could put anything back, because everything I profited was just enough to pay my bills and make sure my wife was taken care of, my kids had growth. But that's all he said. That's all he said to do. He said he was going to give me enough. He said he was going to provide for my bills. He said he was going to provide for my family. Because, you know, that's what we worry about as men. Providing for our family. Being a provider. And that's what I was worried about. But he provides that on a daily basis. And I'm even now, I'm helping. I got a homeless guy that works for me. That's the only guy that I got. But by God, that's my best friend right now. And God's showing me that he's using me to help him get back to where he trusts as well. Because see, he don't trust me. He's worried that I won't pay him because people have done him wrong. People have done this to him, done that to him. But see, that's when I put the ministry part of it. I'm helping him to have joy again through Christ. And that's where I'm at. Learning. I'm still learning. The sanctification process don't stop. It don't never stop. Never. And the greatest thing about it is this. When you learn who you are and your identity, in Colossians, this is what I'm going to say this. In Colossians 1:27, Paul's been talking to the Colossians about understanding God's idea that, you know, telling them, I've heard of the fruits that you bear since you understood God's grace and truth, which is understanding that it's a free gift. And that's what it took for me. That's how I had to get to the process and get to where I am now and get to know who I am, because I understood God's grace and truth, which is a free gift, that it's free. I didn't have to do anything to earn it. Anyways, in 1:27, he says, let me see if I can find it in my Bible, but he says that Jesus revealed the mysteries to the Gentiles that he's never revealed, and all it is Christ in us. The mystery of the gospel, all it is Christ in us. In order to be able to walk in faith and walk in who we're called to walk in, we have to realize that Christ is in us, therefore Christ's identity is in us. Our identity is Christ. To be Christ-like. Yeah, everybody's heard that. Be Christ-like, be Christ-like. I can do one better. Christ is in you. And if we fully and fill up ourselves with the Holy Spirit on a daily basis, and we pray and we read our Bible and we talk to Him, I'm not saying you have to, but when you do, it makes it so much easier to walk in His fruit. Because the Bible in Galatians, it talks about how the fruits of the Spirit is love, kindness, patience, self-control, gentleness, all those things. Has anybody ever tried to be patient on their own? Because I'm going to tell you, I can't do it. I got teenagers and I have no patience about them whatsoever. But when I fill myself up with the Spirit, because see, Don Harbuck, the guy, I love that man, for the Valley Restoration Mission, he told me, he said, those aren't your fruits to bear. Those are Christ's fruits. He says the fruits of the Spirit, not the fruits of Zeke, not the fruits of Christ, Christ's fruit. So in order for us to walk in the fruits and walk in the identity, we have to walk in Christ. And so he's already in us. We just have to walk in and trust in Him to let Him do the change. Let Him do it. That's how I have to do it. I'm telling you right now, if I wouldn't have Jesus, I would not be here right now. If Jesus was not real, I'd be dead under that bridge. I'd be in the grave right now. But the Lord had something in store. And the greatest thing is I can see it now. I've been looking for it. For sure, for the last 4 years, hard looking. trying to go into ministry, trying to go to this church, share my testimony, trying to go over here and share my testimony, trying to do this at the valley, trying to do that, trying to do this. But every time I tried, the door just slammed in my face. Joshua, he gave me a word in the office about a month ago or so. He said, "Do you know that Jesus' ministry didn't start until he was 30? John Baptist's ministry didn't start until he was 30. You couldn't even become a minister until you were 30 in the ministry. I'll be 30 in August." And he just told me to quit my job 2 months before I turned 30. Not only that, he also gave me the vision of what the ministry looks like. I didn't even thought that that's what he would want me to do. I thought that he wanted me to stand behind a pulpit. I thought that he wanted me to be a pastor. But in reality, I would be a minister. I would be ministering to men every day. Because the vision that I have is the same as what y'all have here. To help people that are struggling, help people that are coming out of prisons, that are coming out of rehab. Because I know that when I first got out of rehab and I first went working in construction, because that's the only people that would really hire me unless I wanted to work fast food. And I wanted to make money. I didn't want to make bare minimum. I know that it was really hard for me because, I mean, the first day I was there, I hadn't even been out of rehab in 3 months. I mean, I've been sober for 2 years, but that was 2 years behind bars and in rehab. I went right out there, and they're smoking meth on lunch break. They go into the Porter John's. You go to Porter John, you smell weed in the Porter John. They just doing all the stuff that I shouldn't be around. And it was hard. If I wasn't strong-willed, I'd have fallen right on my face. See, the Lord wants me to use me to set an environment, a Christian environment, to be a Christian company, to where I can offer somebody that's just fresh out of rehab a season of their life to get discipled and to grow stronger in their faith. If they stay with me, they stay with me, but they ain't got to. Everybody that I've had work for me so far, I tell them, you just stay with me if you want to. You don't have to. You leave, I won't be mad at you. You feel like God gave you this, go. I'm not going to stop you. The only thing I want to do is just have you for a couple months. I'll take you for a year if you want to ride it out. It don't matter. However long you want to ride it out, I'm down. But I just want to help you to learn to really walk and see somebody else walking in it. See somebody else is walking in sobriety through faith. That's what, and he didn't even show me that. I mean, I've gone from thinking I'm a youth pastor to being a pastor to being now I'm just a company, a business owner that's going to be helping people through recovery. And heck, I may even still be a pastor. I've been teaching at Grace. I don't know. I just know that he's opening the door. The door's been open. I just ain't been able to walk through it yet. And now he's getting me ready to walk through it. I can't wait to see what happens when I actually turn 30. And everything, the man that you see standing here right now, is all because of Christ. That's it. And everything that you're trying to do now, everything that you think that's, oh, it's not, well, this ain't possible, this is crazy, this is ridiculous, it's possible. It just takes a little bit of faith. I mean, have you ever seen a mustard seed? That's all it takes. Just a little bit of faith. And everything that you're asking for, everything that you want and need, going to do it. And when you get to the point where you've been doing it for a couple years, you're going to look back and be like, dang, that's crazy. That's all I got, y'all. I love y'all, guys.
Pray over.
Yeah, I will.
Okay.
Father God, Jesus, Holy Spirit, I just thank you for allowing me to share my testimony. I thank you for being with us in this room, in this warehouse today, Father. Father, I just ask that you would go out with each and every one of these men and with me, Father, that you would fill us up with your Holy Spirit, that while we walk, wherever we walk, you walk, Father, that your presence would be known because you're in us, and where we go, you are, Father. Let us touch others, Father, each and every one of their situations that they got going on. You know what it is, Father. I just stand and intercede right now in the name of Jesus that you hear them and that you will answer them, and that you will move in their lives, Father. That you will make a mighty move, Father. Father, we ask that you would just continue to help us to grow and continue to sanctify us, that we can walk closer with you, and that we can walk in the newness of you, Father. And I just ask that you would just be with us, man. Just love on us, keep us safe, and give us the peace that surpasses all understanding, Father. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen.
Amen.